God's good to us.
Yes, sir.
And I want you to really pray that God's will be done, because the stage is being set for the coming of the Lord. And we need to be ready.
Amen.
And we need to make sure our hearts is ready. And that's what I see clearly, that I need to make sure that everything about me is what God wants.
Yes, sir.
It's a lot of things I like to do, like pick and carry on, whatever. But I want to make sure my heart is what God wants. I've given my life to Jesus Christ, and He's filled me with His Spirit, and I love Him with all my heart, and He's a forgiving God. But salvation is a growth, and He says that He wants us to keep growing, and it's like the silversmith scraping the dross off, as Proverbs and Ecclesiastes teaches us. And he builds a fire, and the silver begins to melt. He scrapes the dross off, but then he builds a hotter fire and keeps scraping it off. And it says, how long is he going to do it? He says, I do it until I see my perfect image. And Jesus, God wants to see Jesus in us.
Yes, sir.
God doesn't want to see Reggie. He wants to see Jesus. And this world needs Jesus,
yes, sir.
Not me. Our Sunday school was real good to me Sunday, and it was something that has been on my heart. And Brother Junior did good. 9:15 Sunday morning, Sunday school. I wish we could have a building full.
Yes, sir.
But what he taught on was out of Galatians 5, and we might look at that a little while later on. Not the first verse, but maybe after a while. The lust of the flesh, and it lists as 17 plus 1, which makes at least 18. Says if you continually do either one of these, you will not ever inherit the kingdom of God. And see, the flesh is a powerful thing. And it's something that I want to learn and know about. When you come to Christ, what happens when you ask Jesus to wash your sins away? Your sins are washed away.
Right, amen.
And He comes into your life. He comes into your heart. He writes your name into heaven. But yet the Bible teaches us that we are to renew our mind. And I can see that. But there's something that I'm really trying to study. Is the works of the flesh is something that I need to learn more about. Because there's something about the flesh that's more powerful than a lot of people think.
Yes, sir.
The flesh... The Bible says if you love the world, love the flesh, the love of God is not in you. And for God to say, if you do any of these, of the lust of the flesh, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. I begin to ponder, I begin to think. You know, Lucifer was perfect. He really was. And in fact, he was the most beautiful of all the angels. He was a day star. He was the bright one. And he was able to lead worship, and he did great things. Please understand, he was perfect. God created him, not like you and I in His image, but God created all the angels and everything. He gave them a spirit. They are to live forever. But something happened, even though Lucifer was perfect. I turn to the book of Isaiah, chapter 14. It's where I'm going to go first. Isaiah 14, verse 12. Isaiah. I find the Song of Solomon, you know, Proverbs, then I find Isaiah easy going on forward. Isaiah 14. And verse 12. And this is, the main meaning is, I see Lucifer here. More than I see something else that some of your commentaries might try to bring out. But yet many of them do agree with what I have to say. And it's the word of God, and it is exactly what happened to Lucifer. All right, 1 second. Isaiah 14, 12. How art thou falling from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in their heart, in your heart. Okay, what happened here? Lucifer's perfect. And the question is asked, why did you do what you did, Lucifer? Why did you do such a foolish thing or a terrible thing? Why would you even think that? And you know, we do the same thing. We know better than to do a lot of things we do. But notice here, I want you to notice from next two verses I read, it would be all right if you circled them, if you had a Bible you don't mind circling. But I want you to notice how many times you see I. And it's one thing my daddy did to me as he taught me, many things daddy taught me in life, how to live, and he had great wisdom. And I'm not going to go on some of the things, but you know, anybody that can be a prize lightweight boxer and then also high up in the military as far as I'm concerned and many other things, and then have at one time the biggest business in the town of Gloucester, I respect that man. But he had wisdom. But my daddy told me, he said, if a man walks up to you and he begins to brag on himself, this. Keep doing your work. Don't worry about it. But if that man walks up to you and does not say a word, don't you take your eyes off of him. And you know, that's a lot of wisdom.
Amen.
When somebody begins to brag and talk a lot, you know, they nothing to be concerned about. And that's what Lucifer did. He began to run his mouth. Look here at verse 13. For thou hast said in your heart, understand, perfect. Lucifer's perfect. Thou hast said in your heart, what did he say? I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. He says, I'm gonna get even higher than God. I will sit also on the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. And you know, different parts of the Bible brings out how that God is, like in Ezra and different places, he's the God of the north. He sits on the sides of the north. See, Lucifer is saying, I'm going to do that. I'm going to be as good or better than God. It's what he actually is doing. Look at verse 14. What's that first word? I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. But then God says, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell. You know, hell never was. There was never a hell. The Lucifer failed. Why did God build a hell? He built a hell to be a prison for Lucifer. Why didn't God just wipe Lucifer out? God does not go against his word. When he created angels and the beings, he gave them a spirit. He says a spirit will never cease to live. It will be eternal. So God is a God of his word, so he wasn't going to just wipe him out. But God knows everything. God didn't say, oh no, Lord. God saw me and you tonight talking about it. And everything is working out for good. And I praise God. Everything that we're going through on planet Earth today that we don't understand is for God's will, God's good, and one day we'll see it, that it worked together for good. God is coming back soon. The trumpet's going to blow very soon. I might not get to finish this excited message, I don't know, before that trumpet blows. But it don't matter. Praise God. God's coming back.
Amen.
It said, yet thou shalt be, in verse 15, brought down to hell. You see, hell is a prison for Lucifer. That's where he's to spend eternity. Why didn't God put him there to start with? God had a reason. You know why? If God put Lucifer in hell to start with, there would not be a Reggie Foreman tonight. And there would not be a Reggie Foreman in heaven a million years from today. You see, God knows everything.
Yes, sir.
The same way with the hardness of the Jews' heart. There would never have been a Gentile saved. But God is a God of his word. He laid the law down. He told how it was. And some people say, well, you don't have to read the New Old Testament. The Old Testament is important. It's the word of God. And Jesus says, I didn't come to destroy it. I come to fulfill every word of it, and not one word will be changed. Hallelujah. God's good. Satan, you're going to be brought down. Listen, where you're going to be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. Thou shalt sit. They that see thee shall narrowly. And this is, to me, this is going to be, people's going to really shake their heads when they die without Christ, when they follow the way of the world, and then they're going to look where they're going to spend eternity in hell and look who led them there. They're going to say, why did we follow that stupid idiot? Why did we follow such a perverted thing? That's what they're going to do. Look at verse 16. Thou shalt shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble and did shake kingdoms? Verse 17. That made the world as a wilderness. And that's what's happening right now today. This junk's going on now. This world is becoming a wilderness. And the definition of the wilderness is an area where as if no life can survive. That's an odd definition, but it's part of it. And destroy the cities thereof that openeth not the house of his prisoners. So the devil will put somebody in prison spiritually and hold on to them. He's so evil until he gets he gets joy out of making people miserable. But greater is Jesus that's in us than the devil's in the world. The demons cried out, said, Jesus, leave us alone. The devil didn't want the day of Pentecost to come. It came. The church was born. And greater is Jesus that's in you and I than the devil and his work anywhere there is. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
And I want you to see this, that Lucifer failed. And the reason he failed is because he was prideful. He wanted to be lifted up. He wanted to be noticed. You know, he led the music. He led the worship. And he says, I want people to begin to brag on me. You know, I'm doing a good job. I want them to notice me. John the Baptist said these words. John the Baptist says, I'm going to decrease, but he's going to increase. He is before me, and he alone is worthy. And they would come to John and ask him questions. Are you a Christ? Are you a minister? Are you this or that or Elias? You know what he did? He said, no, I'm none of these. But Jesus says, of all the prophets that was ever born, there was never risen one better than John the Baptist. But he never bragged on himself. He lifted up God and Jesus Christ. The next place I want to turn to is in the book of 1 John, which is right next to Revelation, chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We're talking about the power of the flesh, the works of the flesh. I understand that when Lucifer sinned, that you know, he was perfect and he became full of sin, perverted. And as you find 1 John 2, I understand Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, what were they? Perfect. What happened to them? The same thing that Lucifer did, he told Eve the same exact things. You can be as smart as God. You can have this. You can. And she began to listen and look. And we'll see that in a minute. The devil works that way. He comes at you trying to make your natural self, your worldly part. Now, as I said, what got saved? Your spirit got saved. Jesus came into your life. But our body's not saved yet, or it never would sneeze again. It never would have to go to sleep again. It wouldn't have to rest. It wouldn't go around limping or bent over sometimes. Our bodies haven't got saved yet, but the last enemy that's going to be done away with is death, that part. But see, your spirit was saved. But your mind has to be renewed. But our flesh, we've got to do what with it? Crucify. If we do not crucify that flesh, Galatians 5, we're going to look at it, that will hinder us and can even steer us in the wrong way. Our 1 John chapter 2, verse 14. 1 John 2, 14. Make sure I don't get on the wrong place. If you do, you stop me if I'm in the right place and you say praise God or amen. If I'm wrong, say hold on. One time, y'all didn't let me get straight. Y'all let me read half a chapter where I wasn't supposed to be reading. For the sermon goes. 1 John chapter 2, verse 14. And I'm going to go through 17. I have written unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. That's God. I have written, which is the Lord Jesus also. I have written unto you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abideth in you. And look at this word. You have what? Overcome the wicked one. We need to overcome him, and we can do it. We need to study that, how to overcome the wicked one. Look at verse 15. Love not what?
The world.
Neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, look at it with me. The love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, and it lists them. Look, this is important, verse 16. The lust of the flesh, and that's one thing that Lucifer wanted. He wanted to be recognized. The lust of the eyes and the pride of life. It's three things there. And that's three things that we saw in Isaiah 14. And if you study when Lucifer in the wilderness came where Jesus was, when Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights, these are the three things he came at Jesus with. He got Eve with food. He tried to get Jesus with food. He tried the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, but yet Jesus told each time, it is written. All right. Love not the world in verse 15. Neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, those three, is not of the Father, but is of the world. You can put that down. Three of them right there. That's everything else comes under those three. One of those three. Verse 17. The world passes away, the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abides forever. I want to do the will of God. Amen. And I want to learn tonight. Now, Galatians 5, and that's where Brother Junior was in our Sunday school that was so good to me Sunday and got me to really, in fact, I saw something I never saw before. And I'll point that out in a minute. But Galatians chapter 5, the book of Galatians chapter 5, is 17 plus 1, which is 18 works of the flesh, and then it's the fruit of the Spirit, which is 9 of them. So it's twice the amount of flesh that it is. It's more evil than good, but yet the good is more powerful. Hallelujah. All right, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. Walk in the Spirit. You shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I want to learn to do that. But I haven't learned to do that completely yet. I need to learn what God is talking about, to walk in the Spirit. See, Jesus is Spirit. The Word is Spirit. The Word is life. It's the light of my path. And I need to put the Word first, and I need to spend more time in the Word of God. You cannot walk in the Spirit if you do not read the Word of God, because that's the spiritual food. Mm-hmm. We need that. And if I walk in the Spirit, I won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. And the lust of the flesh is so powerful. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not trying to make you wonder or put you down. But the flesh has got more power than you think it does. It really does. I'm going to tell you something that I mentioned once before, and I'm ashamed to say it, but I'm going to tell you about it. This was years ago. But I was a minister, supposedly loved the Lord with all my heart, trying to walk straight and narrow. A group of us, Christian folks, was going into a building, and it had stairs going up to the next floor from the outside. We was going up to, like, to the second floor. So the stairs, you go up, and then you got a porch, and then you go in. As we're going up, here I look up, and there is this person who's a Christian, but I think they got a smarty attitude because of the way they are. I might not be the only one that thought that, but see, I was wrong by thinking that. Do you understand? I was wrong for judging and saying that this is a Christian person. They, right at the top, two or three from the top, I said, you know what would be good for that person is when they get that top step, they just fall off and hit this ground down here. Now, this is the truth, and I never will forget it, and I asked God to forgive me. Guess what happened when they hit that first step? To the ground they went from all the way up there. Hit that ground. But yet we ran down, you know, and they were all right, just a bunged up fall, and thank the Lord for that. But I want you to notice something. I claim to be a Christian. I claim to be born again. We're going in to do what we're supposed to be doing. And I had that thought. Could that be a coincidence? Or is God telling me that you got to be careful how you think?
Yes,
that, in fact, the Bible teaches us even that people can even think things and they come to pass. You can think good or you can think bad. And the Bible says, let's watch how we think. Put the mind of Christ on. Christ would have never thought that. It'd be good if that person would teach them something, they fall off that top step. And they fall off next to this top, they fell off that top step. Just over they went, out to the right.
But could have been that he was using you to knock them back down.
But I tell you what, I felt so bad after that. And I still, that's been maybe 30 years ago, but I never will forget it. I was so wrong. But you see, God wasn't happy with me for even thinking such a word. Because the Bible says if you can't love and forgive everybody you see, there's no way you can love who you cannot see. And it's not necessary I thought something against this person. I just didn't like it because they thought they knew more than everybody else. But I was wrong for even thinking that. They knew more than me. They knew not to think wrong. But that's an example, the lust of the flesh. All right, Galatians 5. Walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Verse 16. And it says the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary one to another, so that you cannot do the things that you would. It's like a war.
It is.
And something that we want to do sometimes, that you see what I'm saying? The flesh has got a lot of power, and it doesn't need to have that. And we need to crucify it. And the only way to stop it from being having power is to take up the cross, follow Jesus, and nail that flesh. You've got to kill that flesh daily. And I tell you what I need big nails with big heads on them. I might need to put a washer on that head because I can nail myself to the cross and then somebody can do something or say something and I can get one arm tore off of there before I know it and begin to say something I shouldn't say, then I feel bad the rest of the day. Some people say, well, you know, I don't believe I'm saved no more. I said, why you don't think you're saved? I believe I backslid. I'm going to hell. Why do you think that? He said, because I said something to somebody the other day, and I feel so bad about it. I said, well, did you say the same thing before to somebody else? Yeah. Did you feel bad about it? No. I said, well, now you're saved, and now you're convicted. And so God wants to forgive us, but I want to get, what I'm saying is I'm serious. I want to learn how to really deal with this old flesh that's stopping me and everybody else from being 100% for God. The works of the flesh are manifest in verse 19. It lists them. Which are these? If you've got a dictionary, you can look them up. It would amaze you on these definitions. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, which in some translations is homosexuality. Lasciviousness, which is in some translations as people who would like to cause divisions and disturbance even in the church. Mm-hmm. I know we don't know nobody like that. Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, that's discord also. Immolations, that's half-hearted, like you're going to serve God half-hearted. Wrath, strife, seduction, heresies, envies, murder, drunkenness, revilings, and then it says, and such the like. So it includes even more than just those 17. Of which I tell you before, as I also told you now, and I'm not saying this, I'm reading the Bible to you, verse 21 of Galatians chapter 5. I told you in time past that they which do such things, what does it say? Shall not inherit the kingdom of God. We cannot practice these things, my friends. We got to be forgiven, we got to crucify them, and we got to deal with them. Yes, we make mistakes every day. If anybody tells you they do not sin ever, what you need to do is to maybe don't say anything. Tell them, but they're wrong. Because the Bible says if you say you don't sin, you are a liar.
Yes, sir.
And even my mind can go a million directions in just a minute. Hallelujah. But the fruit of the Spirit is, and it lists them, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lust. Notice that. They that are Christ have crucified. And that's something I got to do a study on. How do you crucify it like you're supposed to? I need to do that. With the affections and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let's also walk in the Spirit. Now Sunday morning, when Brother Junior was speaking, it came out so clear to me, verse 24. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. But something I never noticed. It says, with the affections and the lusts. So I get my little study to take the Greek words. Crucify the flesh with the affections. That word affection, the first time you actually find what that word means in the Greek, is the passion of Christ when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. In the Garden of Gethsemane, it's when he began to sweat those great drops of blood. That's when he began to take on what he had to take. He made a decision that I'm going to do my will. He says, God, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but thine. Amen. For the first time ever, God had to turn his back and get out of the presence, for the first time ever, out of the presence of his own Son. Who always is and always was the Son of the living God, who is God, the part of the Trinity.
Yes.
But Jesus says, if it's possible, don't make me go through this. Help me, God. The flesh is weak, he said. The Spirit is willing. And see, Jesus is perfect. But what he's doing, he's taking on the weight of the world. He's taking on mine and your sin. Even in the garden, before he's tried, before he's arrested, before he's spit on, beaten, and his beard is pulled out, his hair is pulled, he's been hit in the face many times after he's blindfolded. He says, help me, God, go through this time. In that garden, and the blood that was coming out of it, it was a great pressure. So here we are dealing with the flesh. He says, they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections. The Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. There was a war. There was a war. And the devil can't touch your spirit. But the devil can whisper from your shoulder, trying to confuse your mind. And he would also try to get your mind to misunderstand or to fall out with somebody who don't need to get against or whatever. That's what the devil does to a lot of the churches. People don't get along and don't even know why. I tell you why. Because the devil has divided them. And he knows a house divided against itself won't stand. But let's don't let the devil divide us. Let's bind him. Let's learn what it is. Let's crucify the flesh with the affections and the lust. That's the passion. That's the passion. And you can look in the dictionary. Look the word passion up in the Webster's Dictionary. Try to get the old one. The definition will amaze you. Mm-hmm. It really refers to what Jesus went through in the garden, yes, according to the dictionary I have at my house called Webster's. So, and mine was bought in 1971 for college. So I don't know if the new ones have, you have to get the, they abridge them more and more, mm-hmm, taking out the good words. But God, Webster wrote the dictionaries to help us understand the Bible. So they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affection, with the passions and the lust. So we need to deal with the flesh, crucify and not be condemned. But know this, when you're saved, your name's in heaven.
Amen.
You're washed in the blood. But we need to deal with that old flesh. Because if we don't, we could cause somebody to look at us and say, well, you know, they no different than I am. Mm-hmm. There's no need of me going with them to church. Or they say they're a Christian. I don't see no difference. And it was one great writer one time wrote, he says, if I ever see a redeemer, a man who claims to be redeemed, to live if he's redeemed, I would then believe in a redeemer. I forget who that writer was, but how true that is. Redeemed, our sins have been paid for. But this might not fit you, but I need to learn how to deal with the flesh to keep it nailed to that cross,
yes,
according to Galatians 5. I want to have the love of God. I don't want to do anything to hurt anybody, because heaven's real and so is hell. I want everybody to go to heaven. I love you. And I'm going to ask Brother Bert to dismiss us if he don't mind in prayer. Right.